What could Alex do if he's got someone who's pretty interested and then ghost him? What would you do to try to get them to re-engage?
Alex? I would go negative. And what I mean by negative is I'd pull away. I'd basically say, hey, look, now that it's over, you said you wanted XYZ, but now that it's over, what is it you're gonna do?
I
Something
mean,
along those lines. But I wouldn't, I
they're
the
not even
bottom line
taking
is I
your phone
wouldn't
call
chase them. I
anymore.
would pull away. What
Even when
happened?
they're not taking your phone call, they're not answering your calls. I mean, like, how do we get them re-engaged?
Yeah, so I mean, one of the ways that I've done it, and I've admittedly I've done this more in the real estate space, not necessarily with a coaching client, is I say, look, I must have offended you. I really want to apologize. Like I'll over exaggerate, basically, like you're not returning my calls. I feel like I've offended you. I'm so sorry. Could you ever forgive me? 9 out of 10 times that brings them back in. No, it's not you.
What's the difference? I call them one percenters. A lot of people on this in this room right now are one percenters. They're high earners. They make more money in a week than some people make in a year because they have this self-esteem, this confidence. We're not here to learn how to bully people or intimidate them or corner them. We're here to learn how to protect and make our business grow. So the trouble is, how do we create a memory in somebody where they say, wow, that Claude Diamond was real pushy and everything, but I think maybe he has the solution. Maybe he has the answer. Maybe he can help me solve this problem. The thing about it is, how do we get to yes? How do we differentiate ourselves in a very competitive world? It's horribly competitive. We've got people out there spending 10, 20, 50,000 a month on marketing alone, and they have room full of virtual assistants and all kinds of other managers and things. How can I, one person with no employees working from my home, how can I run a successful business and differentiate myself from my huge competition? I got to do things differently. It's not for everybody, is it? But it's what works. Absolutely. Wait, I'm sorry. I apologize. I kept
No,
you
you're
hold there
fine.
way too long. These
Yeah, no, I
are
think
just such great
I was able
topics
to.
today. I love these topics.
Yeah, no, I think I was able to keep a deal that with by I used the cigarette close on this land deal,
Tell
and I
everybody what
think it was.
that tell everybody what the cigarette close is.
It's so basically at the end of the deal, you basically reaffirm that the person wants to move forward and they don't have any regrets or anything like that. And I did that. And then the next day I got a call, I got an email from the seller, and he said, I talked to my lawyer. It sounds like you're getting a really good deal. And it sounds like, you're paying me a lot lower than what these lots are worth, but a deal's a deal. That's what we agreed on. So, or I'm still going to move forward. And I feel like that was because of the cigarette close when we were talking about it the day before that he stuck to it.
Yeah. And you can fix that a little bit too. Is there something you could add to this to make them feel better? Remember, people make decisions emotionally, but they have to justify them intellectually with your features, benefits, academically, whatever you want to call it. Could you go back and say, you're right. It is, maybe you could get more money, but I'm closing before the end of, I'm going to close before Memorial Day. Maybe if you think, have you ever had a deal fall out where people keep asking for extensions on the closing and things like that? I mean, is it better to get 100% of is it better to get close to your price and know it's a sure thing, or do a few dollars more and maybe you're going to have to wait a lot longer and maybe it'll fall apart? What do you think, sir? How do you feel about that?
No, you're right. Yeah, you're right. And we agreed to it like we talked about
Let
yesterday
me
when we were
ask you something.
comfortable
Do
with it.
you and your lovely wife, I met her on the thing. Do you guys like wine?
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
Okay. I,
red
I
wine's
do,
great.
do you like red or white or both?
Red.
You know what? I got this vineyard, Orfila, Orphilia. It's in Escondido, California. They have the most wonderful buttery Chardonnay. I'm going to send you guys a gift basket. Okay. I just want us to be on good terms, and I want you to feel good about this. Okay, so a little gift from me and my family to yours.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you. Boom. Thank you. I appreciate it.
I just spent $100. What did I, and I'm doing, let's say I'm doing a deal here. It's a good real estate deal. I'm going to make 15, 20, 30, 100,000. Is it worth spending $100 sometimes to put a cherry on top?
Oh yeah. Yeah, for sure.
This is a really good topic. Okay. This guy is, you know, he shared with you that a third party that he trusts said that the deal, you could have got more money, you could have got a better deal. This is the danger about time, by the way.
Yeah.
And, and thank God you did the cigarette close. You recommitted and everything, but it still could be a problem, couldn't it, somewhere down the line?
Yeah, yeah. Because his wife hadn't signed the contract, just he had only signed it. So I was afraid that he was going to back out. So I didn't call him after I got that email. I emailed him back. But I think next time I'll call him
I would call him.
Yeah, like you just said.
Yeah. And sometimes you don't always have to buy an expensive gift or a wine basket or something like that. Could you just compliment? Can you do a little stroking or nurturing? Or could you give him something for the future?
Right, right.
You know, what would that sound like? Give me a Claude. I enjoy doing business with you. You're a man of your words. Give me some cookies.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah. You know, you're a gentleman, Claude. I really appreciate our conversation yesterday, and you know, I'm glad that we were able to talk about this lot, and we're going to be able to do business. You know, I know that you spoke to your friend, and he was a little concerned.
He's not my
about...
friend. He's an attorney.
Oh. Right, right.
We kill our own. Okay, I'm a recovering one.
Well, you know, I didn't want you to have any reservations. I know we spoke about it yesterday, and I just wanted to call you today to make sure. And you know, how about this, just as a sign of goodwill, how about I pay for the closing costs for this transaction on your side?
You don't have to do that, man. That wasn't part of the deal.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, just that's really nice of you. I just don't want you to have any ill will, you know.
If you want to do that, that's really, you know what? Let's just split.
Yeah,
let's split it. That's not fair. Let's just split it.
Okay. Okay. You're a good man. You're a good man, Claude.
Boom. So he's spending
really
much. Okay. So let's say he's making 25,000. He just threw another 2-3,000 into the deal for closing costs. Big deal. Okay.
Right.
Could you go to him and also say, hey, you know what? There'll be, you know, we'll be doing other deals in the future. Would you like to be on my list of when I get a deal, I call people? Or if you have, you said you have other properties, would you like to talk about those properties too? You know,
right.
Lay down the potential for future business.
Yeah. I like that idea.
Do the networking referral angle. What if you know you did a real estate deal with him, but you know he's in the solar, he installs solar panels in California. What could you offer some referrals or something like that?
Oh yeah, yeah, right. Like pass on clients that I'm not able to do.
What would it sound like? Real fast, 30 seconds. What would it sound like? Give me your say. You know what? I want to return the favor, something like that.
Yeah, you know, you've been so great to me. I really appreciate everything. And you know, I know you do the solar business. And I'm talking to people all day, all day, right? So how about you know, can you give me your information or like a website, and I can pass that on to all the clients that I'm talking to.
That'd be great. Oh man, thank you. Really?
Yeah, of course.
You're boom. Now we got a okay. Good, nice going, Wade. Give him a round there. Okay,
Thanks. This
is a bro. It's a bro. What happens in a competitive world where maybe you're more expensive than your competition? You have other obstacles or things like that, or you want a better price in a competitive world, but the prospect is falling in love with you. Can you devastate your competition if you can get them to know, like, trust, or even fall in love with you platonically?
Oh yeah, definitely.
It's a competitive world. How many of us have heard, well, I'm still checking my prices. I'm looking at other companies, other gurus, other programs, other tile manufacturers, other solar companies, whatever. How do you get the prospect when they get off the phone? What do you want them to say about you, Justin?
Claude, you're going to love me because I'm not like any of those other gurus or coaches or realtors or whoever it is you've been talking to. In fact, I'm nothing like them at all.
What do you want them to say when they hang up the phone about Justin?
They're going to say, I love that guy.
That guy made me laugh. I feel good about him. He's not the cheapest. He can't do the earliest delivery time and everything, but there's just something about him. Have we all made decisions about people where maybe it wasn't the best price or anything, but we made a decision emotionally quickly because we felt good about that person? We went with our instincts. Haven't we all done that? How powerful is that in our business? How powerful is that?
Huge.
Yeah. And Mike, going back to what we were talking about earlier, I think sometimes you only have one chance to close in a competitive world. I think you have one shot. You got to go for it. If you can't get a commitment, and there's a lot of reasons why, because sometimes they do need to speak to a partner. The money is still an issue, the timeliness, a lot of other things. Can you still get another appointment? Can you get a specific hard appointment, a follow-up appointment? Can you do something your competition will never do? Maybe send them a video, a follow-up video, send them a gift. How important, I have sent people, I had one customer, this is silly. He loves puzzles, okay? And he loves putting those puzzles together. Somehow it came out in the conversation. And I did not close him, but guess what I sent him through Amazon?
A customized puzzle of your face.
A little, yeah, no, that was, that's not a bad, can you do that? Is that possible?
Oh yeah.
Marketing.
There you go. I went on to Amazon. It cost me $15. I got his mail address. I sent it to him. I called him the next day. Hey, Corey, did you get that puzzle? I just wanted to make sure you got it, buddy.
Yeah, I did.
That
was kind of you.
I know you live in a beautiful, I always say Orange County, but you're not in Orange County.
I'm in Orange County.
You are? Okay. I got you a map of Santa Barbara puzzle, and I thought you'd love it and everything like that. By the way, I've been thinking, you woke me up last night at 2:30. I was thinking about our conversation. Can I ask you a question?
Sure. Fire away.
Then boom, we're back in the sales zone again. Okay. We're back in it again. Is it the money? Is it whatever? Everything. Are we creating a memory in this person about us? In this super competitive world.
Yeah, you took an extra step, which most people don't.
What's a prospect? How much money do we spend on prospects compared to a $15 puzzle or a $100 wine basket or something like that? How much do we really